Well, good morning, everybody. There's a tradition. There's a tradition that goes back in many Christian circles around the world. And the tradition is that when you celebrate the resurrection on Resurrection Sunday or Easter Sunday, that the person at the front says, "He is risen." And then everybody responds with, "He is risen indeed." Now, we're going to say it like we mean it. I want you to say it. I want you to have a crazy look in your eyes. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
He is, and he's here with us. We're here to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ. My name is John Weston. I'm the senior pastor here at Silverdale United Methodist Church. Welcome to this Resurrection Sunday. We're here to worship. We're here to pray. We are here to be touched by the very presence of God. He sends his Holy Spirit, lives in our hearts when we come to him in faith in Jesus. And he wants so much to be with each one of us. He's here with us today. We're going to sing. Would you go ahead and get to your feet? I want to introduce you. This is Caroline Pierce, our music minister. Caroline.
Let's go. So, Christ the Lord is risen today.
Amen. All right, those who are able and want to clap with us, you are very welcome to do that. We need your help.
Christ the Lord is risen today.
keep his prey.
Death cannot keep his prey. Jesus, my Savior, he tore the bars away. Jesus, my Lord, up from the grave he arose with a mighty triumph on his horse. He arose a victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever in his saints to reign. He arose.
Alone is our living hope. Amen to that. Praise God for that.
How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my so great a mercy, what hope can fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from the glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross is spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me is all.
Alleluia.
Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living Lord.
Alleluia.
Alleluia. Praise the one who set me free. Alleluia. That has lost its grip on. Still the promise you buried.
praise you, God.
You deserve the praise. Worthy is Father, we just thank you for this day, this Easter that we celebrate. Oh, we just love you, Lord. Thank you for sending your Son to save us from our sins, a sacrifice to us. And you had your ministry here on earth, and you went to the cross, and you died for our sins. They laid you in the tomb. He was there for 3 days, and you arose on Easter morning. We just thank you for that, God, for that hope of salvation that we have. We just love you. We ask, God, that you would just make this a special day for each and every one that's here. Lord, that they'll receive you in their hearts and their lives. That's our hope. We live with you eternally in heaven in the joy of the Lord. We just give you the praise. We ask God, the Holy Spirit, to fall upon the ears of each and every one here this morning to hear your word. Let not one leave without knowing you coming to Christ. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Is it on? If you have prayer requests, there's a place for prayer requests on the back, and you can mark for them to be confidential, and they actually will go to the prayer chain, which is confidential. Okay. I'll just keep using this one. If you are worshiping with us online, you can find a Connect card on the website under more information about Sunday worship. So we invite you to do that. Also, today, as part of our Easter celebration, we have a brunch afterwards. We would like all of you to join us if you'd like to. Lots of good food, lots of good food. And the offering will be coming up right after the congregational prayer, which Rana will be doing. And the offering there... There are three ways to give. We'll be passing the offering plate, I guess four ways to give. Passing the offering plate, there's an offering box on your way out if you prefer that. Or you can mail a check, and you can see our address on the website. Or you can donate online. So the easiest way, I think, to find our website is just do an online search for Silverdale United Methodist Church. It'll pop right up. And then when you open the website, there's a give tab at the top. So... Welcome. It's so good to see all of you.
Good morning. I love God this morning. How about you? Father God of the rising sun, God of darkness banished, we praise and worship you for the empty tomb. Thank you. For disciples running with good news. Thank you. For your presence alive, powerful, resurrected. Thank you. Thank you that you make all things new. Thank you for the victory and the power that is your name. Thank you that you hold the keys over death. Thank you that by your might, Jesus was raised from the grave, paving the way for us to have a new life with you. Thank you for your plan. Thank you that you made a way. Today we celebrate your victory over death, over all the powers that would defeat us. Help us to truly grasp resurrection, to understand its power, and to see this power at work in our world. Father, on this day of great gladness and every day, please empower us to be your ambassadors, proclaiming the good news. Empower us mightily to be your mobile sanctuaries, to do the work you've laid before each of us in our ministries, with grace, compassion, and great joy. We confess our need for you. We ask that you renew our hearts, our minds, and our lives for the days ahead. We pray for your refreshing over us, Father. Keep your words of truth planted firmly within us. Help us to keep focused on what is pure and right. Give us the power to be obedient to your word. Forgive our sin, redeem the dead places in our lives, and plant new seeds of life and hope. Father, may we live as an expectant people, bolstered by your grace. Lord, where we are afraid, bring peace. Where there is anger and division, bring humility and unity. Where there is exhaustion and fatigue, bring renewal and strength. We profess as your people, your spirit is alive and active. Amen. We affirm that you are working even now to redeem your creation. Could it be that we are uniquely poised to see you move in big ways at such a time as this? Lord, let it be. Help us to be ready as a body. Release your spirit, Father, and let it blow through our needy land. Bind us together as one people in your service. Use us as agents of your grace and move mightily through your church and this planet. The world is hungry for what only you can provide. Only you offer enduring peace. Only you offer victorious hope. Only you offer unconditional love. Scriptures promise that those who seek you will find you, and when they seek you with all their heart. God of awesome joy, be with us this day as we celebrate the resurrection of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Let the light of your love flood into our lives and through us to all those who have been caught in darkness, that your light may give them healing, freedom, and hope. We affirm as your people, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. We seek all this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Now please join me in saying our Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Please join us as we continue to worship the Lord, because he lives.
Sent his son. They called him to Jesus. He came to love, heal, and forgive. He bled and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave. Oh,
For your death and resurrection, that as you died, we die with you and we leave the old behind. And so we are new creations in Christ when we come to know you. And we just thank you for that resurrection life, that we are resurrected with you. And you are our Majesty, our King.
Your Majesty.
Good morning. Stand when able, please, for the reading of his gospel. Today's scripture reading comes from the book of Luke, chapter 24, verses 1 to 12 of the New Living Translation. The resurrection. But very early on Sunday morning, the women went to the tomb, taking the spices they had prepared. They found that the stone had been rolled away from the entrance. So they went in, but they didn't find the body of the Lord Jesus. As they stood there puzzled, two men suddenly appeared to them, clothed in dazzling robes. The women were terrified and bowed with their faces to the ground. Then the men asked, Why are you looking among the dead for someone who is alive? He isn't here. He is risen from the dead. Remember what he had told you back in Galilee, that the Son of Man must be betrayed into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and that we would rise again, and that he would rise again on the third day. Then they remembered that he had said this, so they rushed back from the tomb to tell his 11 disciples and everyone else what had happened. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and several other women who told the apostles what had happened. But the story sounded like nonsense to the men, so they didn't believe it. However, Peter jumped up and ran to the tomb to look. Stooping, he peered in and saw the empty linen wrappings. Then he went home again, wondering what had happened. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Is one of the followers of Jesus. He's late in the game. And he's an important leader in Israel. He's very rich. And the story is that Joseph donated his tomb for Jesus to be buried in. And now what the Bible doesn't tell you is that this tomb had the very best that the 30th century, the year 30 AD had to offer. All marble exterior, paintings and murals inside, gold trim around all the entrances and the portals. I mean, it was really incredible. And so he's talking to his friends afterward, and his friends are saying, Joseph, what were you thinking? Why would you donate such an expensive tomb to the poor son of a carpenter? You know, whoa, I mean, isn't that a pretty... that's a pretty big gift. And then Joseph, he looks at his friends, he says, well, yeah, but, you know, it was only for the weekend. In reality, Joseph, he took a huge risk in giving his tomb, and basically he outed himself as a follower of Jesus. And to do so, praise God. And in doing so, he was taking great risk. Jesus had just been executed. And it was very likely, very possible that any other high-profile leaders in the group could also follow suit. So he could have lost a job. Things could have gone really, really badly. But instead, the resurrection transformed everything, transformed all those relationships. Today we're going to be talking about new life. In fact, we're starting a new series. The series is called New Life. And today we're going to be talking about relationships. So a few of you might be thinking, like, so we're on Resurrection Sunday, we're going to talk about relationships? You know, what about the historical import of a man coming back from the dead? What about the beginning of the Christian movement? What about what about that? What about physics? And is this even possible? And what about relationships? And so my response is, well, if Jesus really did rise from the dead, then, and if, because of that, all people with faith in him can live forever, what are you going to do at that time? And the answer is relationships. No joke. So when you have new life, when you believe in Jesus, you get Jesus. It's more than an opinion. It's more than a mental exercise. It's more than a ritual or a philosophy. It's not something that you vote on in your head. When you believe in Jesus, you get Jesus. You get Jesus. The Holy Spirit comes and lives inside of you, helps you, forms you, sharpens you, reminds you that you have become a child of God, makes you a part of God's family, gives you the power to do things and help people in ways that are just, since I've been following Jesus, I've seen things happen, sometimes through my help, some oftentimes not, that are just beyond, humans can't plan and can't accomplish the things that God does. So when you believe in Jesus, you get Jesus, and he will bring new life to your relationships. That's part of the package. Now, I don't want to downplay the importance of the resurrection. And so I want to give you some reasons for believing in the resurrection. With all this relationship talk, we don't want to miss out on this. And some of you might be thinking, you know, relationships, I don't even know if I think this is real or if this is even possible, let alone what it's going to do for my relationships in my life, how it's going to help me self-actualize or whatever you Christians would term it. And if that's feeling more like you today, I want to give you a few reasons to consider the Bible's claims that about Jesus' death and his resurrection, and some reasons why we should accept this claim as a historical event, not simply a belief as a part of a faith movement, all right? So first of all, the first major reason for believing in the resurrection is Josephus corroborates both Jesus' existence and the manner of his death. Josephus was a Jewish historian. He was not known to be a Jesus follower, not a Christian. Josephus was roughly a contemporary of Jesus, lived in the first century, and recorded events and things that he was able to take firsthand, things he was able to hear firsthand reports of and put it together. And Josephus clearly references Jesus, that the fact that, and not just that he existed, or that even that he died, but that Jesus had a wide following, that he was known for performing miracles and things that people weren't able to explain. Josephus is a historical source outside of the New Testament, outside of the Bible, that confirms that Jesus was a real person. And Jesus was a very public, very important figure in Israel back at that time. So from that, we get an outside, extra biblical. Yeah, use that one to impress your friends at brunch today. Extra biblically speaking. Extra biblical source shows us that Jesus existed, not just those Jesus people. Second reason that you should take the resurrection account seriously in the Gospels, the details in the Gospels make sense. Now, if you're not someone that believes in angels moving giant, you know, stones that would take two or three or four guys and some really big crowbars to get a tomb open, then you've still got to explain that somehow these women were able to get into the tomb. And even though the Romans knew it was a high-profile execution and they had extra security that had been assigned to the tomb was open somehow. And an angel sure does help that little detail fall into place. Another detail you find in the Gospels is that the body, where the body was itself in the tombs, all four Gospels tell us that the wrappings that had been around Jesus' body, it would be sort of like a mummy a little bit. So you just kind of wrap him, you know, with gauze or some light fabric, and you get them all wrapped up, and all the witnesses that were at the tomb that day, they all share that there were wrappings that were neatly deposited. They were just sitting there on the table. In fact, the cloth that had been around his head was neatly folded. Everything else was just, it was all neat and together. It wasn't just, you know, everywhere. Like, we've been redoing the computer, the network connections here in the sanctuary. Some of us were here pretty late last night. And so we had this huge pile of blue spaghetti up in the balcony. I mean, that stuff was everywhere. And, you know, but we got stuff routed and placed and everything, and some of that spaghetti's been tamed. But when you're in a hurry, you don't always do things as neatly. You just wait for cleanup to come later. If somebody is stealing a body, who is going to take the body, unwrap it, put the wrappings neatly in place, and then take the body minus the wrappings? Nobody does that. That's the train to Crazy Town. So you have to explain, you know, there's details like that. We know, for example, that Jesus really was dead. I mean, you know, you look at John's account, we find out that when he was on the cross, that after he had expired, that the soldiers, they stuck a spear in his side, and an eyewitness tells us that his blood had separated because it had been sitting and he had been dead long enough that his blood was starting to, you know, water and all the other the content. I mean, it's just that's a detail. That's, you know, that's, you're clinically dead when that happens. He really was dead. There's a lot of details in the scriptures that are things that you wouldn't think to include, but really, yeah, that really does make sense. And they did include those things because it does all, in fact, add up. So there's a lot of details in the gospel that make sense if Jesus died and then came back from the dead. All right, and then finally, I think that probably the greatest evidence for Jesus' resurrection is this. It's there's no other way to explain the shift in morale for his followers. Morale shift. You know, like, it's like, you know, when you're watching, you know, sports fans, you know, you're watching a basketball game, you're watching your favorite team, and they're getting beat. And it is really hard. You have to have an incredible locker room talk at halftime to be able to come back out on the field and to put it together when you've just been getting your clock cleaned during the first half. The disciples have just gotten beat down. Their leader, Jesus, is gone. They watched him. He's been executed publicly. It's brutal. It's meant to discourage. It's meant to demoralize. It's meant to make you feel depressed. It's a message to any one of his followers that if you don't shape up this nonsense, you're going to be next. The crucifixion is designed to make movements crumble, to bring people into submission. That's just how it works. And yet, Jesus' disciples, his followers, the men and the women, after just 3 days, they go from hiding and depression and doing all the things that normally happen, and then somewhere at the three-day mark and after, something takes place, and then there is this huge turnaround. Huge turnaround. And this movement, they go from grieving and feeling fear and brokenness, trauma, PTSD. This is a recipe for PTSD. To gathering, hanging together, and planning their next ministry event. How do you explain that? How do you explain that? I think it's harder to explain that the disciples were lying about the resurrection. I think that one, it's like Peter and a few of the others, they're like, oh, what are we gonna do?
And so he says, okay, everybody, come together. Okay, everybody. All right, look, now we're all pretty bummed about Jesus. And we're going to miss him. But turns out we still have an account balance in the fund, in the funds, although we do need a new treasurer. But you know, Jesus, he would want us to, you know, look on the bright side. So, all right, so he's gone. Not really sure what we're going to do. But, okay, this is it. Okay, we're going to tell everybody. Remember, we're going to tell everybody that he came back from the dead. Yeah, that's going to be the story. So we're all on the same page. Everybody got that? All right, we're going to tell everybody he came back from the dead. And we're going to get out there. And we're going to, you know, I bet... And we'll probably last for months, maybe years, before the authorities get us. And then, but I'm telling you, I bet fundraising, I bet we'll see a 20 or 30% increase before the end of the year. Yeah. 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 Oh, wait, what was that, Thomas? Oh, you mean before they kill us? Yeah. Well, there's that. Okay. No, everybody? No, everybody on in. Okay, resurrection secret on three. Okay, ready? Come on, guys. One, two. Oh, come on, you guys. No. This is going to be great. It's not going to fly. Not ready for prime time. Trying to motivate a group of people who have been demoralized, who've seen this great teacher just get slaughtered by the system. How do you sell that? How do you? You can't. It stinks on ice. Nobody's going to go through with that. There's no way to explain the sudden shift in morale of Jesus' followers. See, Jesus' resurrection gives new life to relationships. It brings people together. It changes the way that you see the people around you, the people that are close to you. Let me give you some examples. All right. So there's Mary and Mary. Everybody was named Mary back then. Mary, Joanna. Hey, did you know that Mary comes from the name Miriam? You know, Moses' sister? Yeah. Very popular. I mean, like I said, you know, those three, Moses, Aaron, and Miriam, like they were the first family of Israel for a lot of years. Everybody wanted to name their daughter after them. So Mary Magdalene, one of the other Marys, not Jesus' mother Mary, but one of the other Marys, Joanna, they're the first ones at the tomb. They're really sad, you know, they're just going to go, and if people know that they're Jesus' followers, too bad. Maybe the women figured that because they were female, there was less of a chance that they would be crucified like the guys. You know, if you were one of the 12, then... You know, that's the reason that they were hiding out, probably still in the upper room where they had shared the Last Supper. Probably, you know, that we know that they were behind locked door and you know, anybody that tried to come in, you know, who's there? You know, looking through the little slit. They weren't sure what they were gonna do next. Mary, and Joanna encountered Jesus. They were the first ones to receive the good news. They were the first ones to see him. And when they first find the empty tomb and they see the angels and they go back to share the story with Peter and the others, you remember what happens? Yeah, they get blown off. See, the guys don't believe it. You're hysterical. Come on, no. So they get blown off. But Peter, after he gets done blowing them off with the rest of the guys, it's like a little alarm bell in him kind of goes off, and he's like, you ever see a guy who tells you like, no, that's no way that, and then they go and actually check it out, you know. That's what Peter does. So Peter and John, they go to the tomb, and they discover that, in fact, it's empty, and all the wrappings are all neatly there, and something happens, something's weird. Something's different. There's something that's not going on. These relationships are falling apart. The men, the women, the divide, the whole movement is crumbling. But when they see Jesus, when his resurrection comes front and center, when they know that Jesus really did rise from the dead, then it brings them all together again. Women are talking to the men are believing the women, the trust is coming back. It's all coming back. It's all coming back. All right, another example, Cleopas. Cleopas, parents, don't name your kid Cleopas. I'm sure it was great back then. Sounds like something from the Andy Griffith Show or something, you know? It's like, I don't know. Cleopas is in the garage again. He's underneath the car. We got to get the fireman. There we go. Cleopas and his friend. This actually takes place right after the reading. So Ellen just got done with Luke 24, first section, 1 to 12. Well, the next section in there, you should check this out. Cleopas and his buddy are Jesus followers. They're heading out of Jerusalem. They're going to a town called Emmaus. It's seven miles, which walking, that's, you know, somewhere around a 3 or 4 hour walk if you're really walking like you mean it. And they're heading to Emmaus, this small little community. They are completely demoralized because, you know, I want you to think about what it would be like. Jesus is gone. The people that were really close to each other and were close to Jesus, they're staying in Jerusalem. They're grieving. They're hiding out together. But Cleopas and his buddy, nope, they're just done. They're just gone. Because Jesus was the glue that held those relationships together. You know, it's like years ago, I did a funeral for a family where the dad was the glue in the family. And after the dad passed away, like the sons weren't even like talking to each other. So like we're sitting there like during the memorial service and like they're getting that open mic, sometimes not a good idea. And they're like talking things about each other, like on the mic in front of everybody in the room. I mean, it just, because dad was the glue. He wasn't there to kind of rein them in and sort of help them remember about love and the family and what this is about. So things were just kind of coming off the tracks, and Jesus was the glue for Cleopas and his buddy. Like these were, you know, decent people that, you know, they wanted to serve and make a difference in people's lives. But now that Jesus was gone, it's just, you know, stay in Jerusalem and risk getting arrested, risk crucifixion. No thanks. We're going to Emmaus. Bye. See ya. We're gone. We're out of here. And they're on the road, and Jesus comes up and he's just walking with them, and he's got this supernatural thing going where it's like it's him, but they don't know it's him. It's like, and he starts talking to him, says, "Hey," and he says, "What's the matter?" And he said, "You mind if I walk with you?" And says, "Sure." And so they're just walking down the road, and then he says, "You guys look kind of down," and they said, "What are you talking about? Did you hear about what happened over the weekend? Jesus of Nazareth was executed, and they crucified him, and he's gone, and you really haven't heard about this?" And then Jesus is like, and so they start talking shop. They're talking theology, and they're talking the Bible, and Jesus is telling them about prophecies. Like, didn't the Bible say that the Messiah, the Anointed One, that he was supposed to suffer and even die? And I mean, it kind of makes sense in a way. And they're thinking like, "Who are you?" Like, "Well, yeah, okay, yeah, it actually makes a lot of sense." And so anyway, they get to Emmaus, and they've been talking the Bible together, and the guys talk Jesus into staying the night with them, because Jesus is like, "Well, I'm just going to keep on. I'm heading out. I got a few more miles to go." And they say, no, it's late. You know, you just come. Have dinner with us. Stay with us. You can go in the morning." So he says, "Okay." So they have dinner together, and while they're having dinner, Jesus, you know, kind of plays the host, you know, sort of like, you know, "Would you want me to do anything? You want me to, you know, build the fire or set the table?" "Well, no, you can break the bread." "Okay." And so Jesus breaks the bread, and then they see him. It's just like, whew, cloaking device deactivated. It's Jesus, and then he disappears. And then Cleopas and his friend, you know, it's already evening, or maybe it's late, maybe it's later days. Of course, they did not have daylight savings time. So it's getting close to dark at this point. They immediately, I don't think they even finished dinner, probably didn't. They immediately throw everything off and they head right back to Jerusalem, which means at least the second or third hour of the trip is going to be in total darkness. And this is why it leads me to believe that it's Cleopas and his companion is not his wife. Now, there's some people who think that, well, one of the women who was at the cross when Jesus was crucified was the wife of, the gospel says Cleopas, which is really close, Cleopas, Clopas. So maybe, you know, it could be the same person, but, you know, the fact that these two guys were like, we're going back tonight. We got to tell people tonight. And we're in the dark on this long road trip and everything like that. Women have way more common sense than that. They'd be like, we can wait till morning. So I don't think it was Clopas and his wife. I think it was Clopas and one of his other buddies. And they make the trip and they get there like, you're not going to believe this. He was right there with us. And at that point, Jesus is already, he's just showing up. He's meeting people, person after person after person. It's all happening. So Clopas and his friend. And then finally, you see, it changes everything. Because I'll bet these two guys who were just demoralized and wanted to just be done with this whole ministry thing, with this whole, you know, living for God thing, and just, they were just done. And then after Jesus' resurrection, you couldn't pry these guys away from their local church with a crowbar. Because they just know. They've seen him. They're experiencing him. And they're hearing about other people have also are having these experiences. And actually, it makes a lot of sense in the Bible. And wow, this is huge. Another example of relationships being changed by the resurrection, Peter. Now think about Peter, all right? Let's think about this. So rewind 72 hours before the resurrection, and what's happening? It's Thursday night, Last Supper, and during the Last Supper, what is Jesus? You know, they go out. They're in the Garden of Gethsemane. Judas shows up. Oh, Jesus! Hey, guess what? Jesus gets turned over, and before all this happens, What does Peter tell Jesus? He says, I'm going to be there with you to the end, even to death. And as soon as the soldiers show up and as soon as Jesus is arrested, what does Peter do? Pew! He's gone. But then he's just like, And then again, little alarm goes off, and he's like, I'm going to tail him. So he's you know, kind of lurking in the shadows and you know, trying to act like incognito, you know, and he follows Jesus all the way to the compound where the high priest's house, and he's out there in the courtyard, and the last eye contact that Jesus makes with Peter is right the moment when Peter is saying, Jesus who? Jesus of Nazareth? No. I don't know that guy. I don't know what you're talking about. I'm not from Galilee. They make eye contact. Peter has done multiple times what he said he was going to do. He took off from Jesus the first time, and then he tried to turn around and make it right, and then he did it again and again. So if you're Peter, you're in an awkward situation. If Jesus really has come back from the dead, then what's he going to do to me? Because we didn't really part on the best terms. And if Jesus hasn't come back from the dead, may God help me. May God have mercy on me. And yet, for all of that, when Jesus comes, Jesus transforms that relationship, transforms all of Peter's relationships. We find out that a few days afterward, they're up in Galilee. Jesus shows up again. Peter and some of the other disciples, they're out fishing. Jesus is on the beach. He waves them in from their boat. The boat comes in. Jesus has breakfast for them over the fire, hot fish and fresh bread. And so during that time, Jesus makes a moment for Peter. You know, everybody's talking and talking about old times, starting to talk about, well, what do we do now? And then Jesus takes Peter aside and he makes it right. He makes it good with him. He forgives Peter. He gives Peter his job back, makes it really clear to him, you are back, you are in, you're going to do this. You're going to do great things for God. Because Jesus' resurrection transforms relationships. When I let Jesus into my life, I have a broken family I grew up in with, you know, lots of, you know, multiple marriages. At one point, I had 3 active stepmothers at the same time, simultaneously. And one of the relationships, my stepdad, strong personality, he was someone that sometimes growing up, just things were hard. We weren't always the best kids, and he wasn't always the best stepdad. And when we all grew up, a lot of us just kind of left him behind. And I still had that relationship, but one day God showed me that, you know, you need to forgive him. So I did. And because of that, that relationship changed. My siblings didn't do the same thing. And so but I got to enjoy a lot of years with him. And when he passed away this last summer, then I had peace because the resurrected Christ had come into my life and had helped and had transformed that relationship and taken it from something that was broken, something that neither one of us had done a great job in, and turned it into something beautiful that I got to enjoy and let my kids experience. And see, the empty tomb makes a full upper room. See, the upper room is very likely the place where Jesus' disciples, you know, they rented it out initially for the Last Supper, but then they ended up together for weeks waiting in Jerusalem, waiting for the Holy Spirit to come. Jesus told them, just go into Jerusalem, just wait for the gift that my Father has promised. Just go and wait. And they're there, and there's over 100 of them who are spending every possible moment in that upper room. And they're talking, they're fellowshipping, they're visiting, they're praying, probably fasting some of the time, and they just know that God's going to do something big, something good. And they've got these friendships where it's like, where you have people around you, you've surrounded yourself with people who have a common experience. That's something that we do as human beings. You know, you hear stories about, you know, guys that fought together, that saw action, you know, in wartime. You know, men who have fought in World War II or Korea or Vietnam. And in some cases, some of these guys, you know, the kinds of things that they saw, it was really hard. It was horrific. And the only people that they feel safe talking to these things about are their buddies that were there with them on the battlefield that had those same experiences. It bonded them together. There are certain things that they can only share that it goes so deep in them because you had to be there. And when you let Jesus' resurrection into your life, when you let him give you new life, that will give you an experience. It will take you to a place where you can wait on God and serve God. There will be people in your upper room, people that will journey with you, people who are ready to encourage you and help you and pray with you, and you will encourage and help them, and you together, you're going to figure out, what's next? What's God going to do next? See, the empty tomb fills the upper room. God will transform your relationships. He will give you a heart to love people that previously you might have you taken for granted, or people that you just may have just didn't have any time for, didn't have the love for. The empty tomb fills the upper room. When you believe in Jesus, you get Jesus. Let him fill your upper room. Let him change those relationships. You know, think about Peter. Because not only did Jesus reconcile Peter's relationship with him, but he gave Peter a strong marriage. Tradition tells us that Peter and his wife were executed together. crucified together. The ministry that they shared, it's a tough road. And they paid the highest price. But for all that stress and everything they went through, their marriage lasted. The empty tomb makes a full upper room. The resurrection of Jesus will transform your relationships. We want you to be a part of something that's not just bigger, that's not just bigger and better and really deep and philosophically interesting. No, we want you to be a part of something that is going to last forever. Because when Jesus rose from the dead, he broke the death barrier for all time. Now, when we face death, we all face death. Every single one of us, regardless of your age, we all face death. And Jesus is the only one who has gone right, barreled right straight through it and come out on the other side and can't come back to said, okay, it worked, come on, here we go, this way. I'd stake my life on it. When you believe in Jesus, you get Jesus. A few things are going to happen. We're going to have a chance to be able to, we're going to have some prayer time while we're doing our last song. And if there's anything you want prayer for, if you've got someone you're worried about, someone who's sick and in the hospital, you got a big decision you're trying to make, if you have some kind of something you're struggling with, or you've got a physical challenge, whatever it is, sickness, an injury, whatever, let our prayer team pray for you. It just take a couple minutes. So many people have found inexplicable relief when they've let people pray for them in this room. So you're going to have a couple minutes to do it. It's not going to take all day. We're not going to be like having you make a formal statement. We're not going to be publishing all the things that you share on the church website or on our Facebook page or anything. Just come. It's confidential. Let God in. Just take a couple moments to seal and to sanctify this day, just to make this a holy day, whatever that is. So if the Holy Spirit is kind of nudging you, if that little alarm's going off, then you should come up. Because it'll make you crazy not knowing what could have happened. And if you're at the place where you need to let Jesus in, you need to make sure that he knows that you know that he is in and you want to mark this day, come forward, pray, let one of our prayer team know, because we will be so fired up. We're not going to be like embarrass you or anything, but we will be so fired up for you. You don't have to walk alone. Tell someone. And then finally, if you're a guest with us today, and this is your first time, or maybe you've only been to this church a couple times before or whatever, I want you to come to the five-minute party. Five-minute party, it's going to take place about 5 minutes after worship, the way things have been going, maybe six or seven, but probably 5 minutes after worship. And it's going to be, there's going to be a table right inside the social hall. It's got a green tablecloth, little table tent. Five-minute party, 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 party. Come to the five-minute party. It will only last 5 minutes. And we'll just tell you a little bit about the church, answer any questions you have. We have an awesome gift for you. So it's first come, first serve. If we run out of gifts, leave us an address. We will get a gift delivered to you. But we've got a limited number of the gift that are here. So the first people that are there will get the gift. Everybody will get a gift in the end. But for the people that come first, they'll be able to take their gift home today. So, five-minute party. It's going to be great. Let's see. Chris, am I forgetting anything else?
Brunch.
Connect card. That's it. If you're just here connecting at SUMC, I think we've got, do we have connect cards in the pews? Or were they in the program? Above in the bulletin? Excellent. All right. Fill out your Connect card. You got a prayer request, whatever that is. You can drop that in the offering box on the way out. That'd be great. If you want to do our digital Connect card, a lot easier, nothing to lose, you dial area code 360-844-3011. So 360-864-3011. Just text H-E-R-E here. And then we'll get you connected and make sure that you, if you want our newsletter or want to learn a phone call or whatever, you just make sure you're able to connect. All right. So right now the Holy Spirit's telling some of you you're supposed to come up and pray. Spooky. He's so kind. He is so good. So we're going to worship. I'm going to pray for us. God, I ask that you would give courage to anyone that's supposed to come up. Just let them know how much you love them and just how we love you so much, God. Just whatever the need is, Lord, let those people come. And we want to love people the way you love them. And we want to see relationships healed. We want to see relationships grow. We want to have your heart for the people around us, starting with our family, starting with our friends. And even, Lord, even for strangers that we don't know yet, future friends, we want to love people the way you love them. And we believe that you will do that as a part of your resurrection life in each one of us, your new life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. All right, so I'm going to invite the altar team to come on up, and we're gonna close out with worship. If you want to go ahead and stand up, let's stretch, and let's worship the Lord together.
Let's say it one more time. Christ is risen.
He's risen indeed.
Look to your left and say to the person, he is risen.
He is risen indeed.
And then they will say, he is risen indeed.
He is risen.
Very good.
Amen.
Good class.
Church, let's sing this song after our hands to our God.
Lord, I lift your name. Jesus. Amen.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance over you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And all God's people said,
Amen.
Amen.
Let's go eat.
Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. Oh, yes. I'm so glad you came to save.
Out of sync. Me too. Hi. How are you doing, friend? Oh, yeah, you're welcome. Thanks. Yeah, good. She's just, she's still but waiting, and I don't know, there's been some problems. Okay. Yeah, well,